Okay, our next speaker is Philippe Poirotier from Belgium, and he's working for Eurocontrol, where he manages about 2.5 million lines of IDA code.
2.3.
2.3, correct.
Yes.
Well, it seems to be
2.5. We will reduce to the...
Okay, please.
Okay, so today I will speak about tracking performance of a big application from development to operations. In fact, what I will discuss is not too much related to ADA. In fact, yesterday there was even zero slide in my presentation containing a line of ADA code. And so I was a little bit afraid that the dev room organizer would kill me after the presentation. So I added one slide. In fact, I was joking when I said that they would kill me after the presentation because Jean-Pierre, one of the dev room organizers, in fact, is working for me because I'm paying him to support the ADA control tool that we use to check the coding rules of our code. And Dirk Reynest, absent today, the second DevRoom organizer, is working in my team, so they have reasons not to kill me, except maybe, of course, Dirk. Dirk might have a reason to kill me because he's working for me. Voilà. So, let's switch to the next slide. What are the objectives of performance tracking? So the objective of performance tracking is to evaluate, measure resource needed by new functionalities. That's one objective. Another objective is to verify the estimated resource budget, CPU memory of what you develop. So we want also to ensure that the new release will cope with the current or expected new load. And we want to avoid performance degradation during development. For example, imagine that we have a team of 20 developers working 6 months on a new release. That's about the size of the team working on this application. And let's imagine that a developer integrates X changes per month. And if one change on X degrades the performance by 1%, then optimistically, after 6 months, we have a new release which is 2.2 times slower. We start from performance 100%, 6 months, 20%, 1%. That's the optimistic view. The pessimistic view is that the new release is 3.3 times slower. We start from 100% times 1.01 to the power of 120. So clearly we have to do something and we cannot wait the end of the release to check the performance and see where the degradation is coming from. And so the objective is to do a daily track of the performance during the development. So we have a development performance tracking objective which is relatively precise because we want to reliably detect performance difference of 1% or less. So, a little bit of explanation about Eurocontrol. So, a little bit of explanation about where I'm working and what we are doing. So, Eurocontrol is the European organization for the safety of air navigation. So it's an international organization with 41 member states. I would like to draw your attention on the fact that it is 41 and not 40 since last midnight. We have several sites, directorates, etc. The activities, we have operations, handling management of the traffic in Europe. We do concept development. We do some European-wide project implementation and support, etc. More info on our website. Where I'm working is the Directorate of Network Management. It has nothing to do with network, routers, cable, and so on. It manages the network which is used by the flights to fly. So we have routes, we have points, we have air routes. This is a network, and that's what we manage. We develop and operate the air traffic management network. So we have different operational phases. We have strategical. We prepare the network, the restructuration of the network and so on months or years in advance, pre-tactical, a few days in advance, tactical, today, tomorrow, post-operation, we have to analyze what has happened and maybe improve for the future. So we are doing airspace route data, flight plan processing for complete Europe, flow and capacity management. So if you have an airspace control center and you have too many flights that are planned to fly through this airspace control center, the controller might be overloaded, which is not good for your safety. And then the idea is that our systems will detect this load and then provide mechanisms in order to balance the capacity and the load. So, network management, we have two mission safety critical systems. So these are AFPS flight plan processing and ETFMS flow and capacity management. And my team is developing these two applications, which share quite a lot of code, in ADA. ADA is by far the main language used. We have something like the core of the system is 99% ADA. So some more words about AFPS and ETFMS. So it's big application. The core is 2.3 million lines of code. And then around we have shell scripts for the build infrastructure, for the monitoring. We have a lot of test code around, etc. So in terms of capacity, let's speak about a peak day of ETFMS, the flow management system. So in Europe, we have about in peak more than 37,000 flights to handle. And we have around 8.6 million radar positions, and these are planned to increase to 18 million in 1 year because we will add new sources of position, namely the ADS-B data provided by new systems. So we have from external users, so the aircraft operator, Air France, British Airways, and so on, the airports, the air traffic control center, they all query our systems in order to have data, and this results in about 3.3 million queries per day in peak. And we are publishing changes on the flight data through publish subscribe mechanisms such as AMQP, and we have more than 3.5 million messages per day to publish. So what hardware do we run on? So the online processing is done on a Linux server 28 core. So it is not a small server, but it's by far not a huge, huge setup. We have some workstations that are running a graphical user interface for our internal flow controllers. And on these workstations, because they are quite powerful, we are also doing some batch processing and some background jobs. So we have many heavy queries. We have complex algorithms that are called a lot. For example, we have queries such as count or give me a flight list for all the flights that are traversing France between 10 o'clock and 20 o'clock. We have some algorithms like lateral route prediction or route proposal optimization. We have vertical trajectory calculation. I'll show after some drawing to show a little bit the complexity. And a lot of other things you can imagine in 2.3 million lines of code, we do a lot. So this is a graph of a flight departing somewhere in Turkey, arriving somewhere outside of the European Union. And you see that when we have to calculate a trajectory, so for example, these orange stuff that you see here are radar position. And each time the system receives a radar position, it has to detect if it is far or not from the planned trajectory. And if it deviates a lot, it has to recompute the trajectory. We also, so this is just computing one or several routes if the aircraft operator changes the flight plan for a flight. But what we also provide as a service is a route optimization service. So they can call our system and say, please find me a good route. And then we have to start to search maybe this way, maybe this way, maybe this way. Of course, basically, it's a shortest path algorithm, Dijkstra, but we can't use purely a Dijkstra. It's a lot more complex than that because there are constraints which cannot be modeled in a simple graph. And so even searching, let's say, the n shortest route is a lot more complex than a typical similar problem. problem. This is the same fly that we have seen, but on a vertical view. So we see it departs here, and we land there. And we see that we have plenty of constraints, like forbidden airspace. We have some levels that have to be respected. We have blocks of airspace that can be traversed or not, depending on the direction and other conditions. So you see that our algorithms that we have to make are quite complex. For this algorithm, for example, the algorithm that search where the fly can fly, we have per day several hundred of millions of calculation to do per day, which are done either on the central server or in batch or background jobs on workstations. So performance needs and ETFMS scalability. So as we have indicated, we have a lot of users, we have a lot of queries, and so we need horizontal scalability for this or operational configuration of our main server, because we have a lot of instances of this software, because we have, for example, an instance of the same system, which is doing the prediction for the next week, for example. We have standalone systems that are used to study what happens in several months. Here I'm speaking about the operational system. So on our 28-core system, we have 10 high-priority server processes that are handling the critical input, so the flight plan, the radar position, the external user queries. We have 9 lower priority server processes having each 4 threads, which are handling lower priority queries, such as find me a better route for flight Air France 123. We have about up to 20 processes running on workstations, which are executing this batch job or background queries. For example, every hour, search a better route for all flights of aircraft operator British Airways departing in the next 3 hours. And that, of course, is quite a high load. We also need vertical scalability. So this is a little bit different of systems where you can have a lot of users asking a lot of queries and you can distribute it. And that's what we do. But we also have some functionalities like simulation where one single user needs a lot of power, because we have our internal flow controllers. They have sometimes to take heavy actions, like if an airport calls or an airspace control center calls and say, we have a problem, we have a technical problem, and we have to take maybe 1,000 flights, and we have to find how to best handle these 1,000 flights. All these actions will be done on the complete set of flights in the system, and so we must provide to our flow controller a functionality which goes fast for a lot of changes. So we need vertical scalability, so something very fast, for example, to evaluate heavy actions such as we close an airspace, we close a country, and we have to spread, reroute, or delay the whole traffic impacted. So to give an example, starting a simulation, it implies to clone the whole traffic from the server to the workstation. It's a very fat client. And we need to recreate the in-memory indexes which are needed to execute all these algorithms and so on. So it's about 20 million in-memory indexes that we have to recreate. And in the release we are busy developing, we have spent quite some time to optimize the start simulation. We are now starting a simulation in less than 4 seconds, including bringing the data from the server. And this is with using multi-threading. So we have one task that decodes a flight data received from a stream from the server. One task creates a flight data structure once it is decoded. And we have 6 tasks which are recreating the indexes. Okay, so what we have seen now is that we have high performance requirement and we can't degrade, and so we have to track performance during development. And one thing we can use for that is performance unit tests. So performance unit tests, these are useful to measure things such as basic data structure, hash table, binary trees, and so on. For example, here you see that we have a performance unit test, which is checking the speed of an insert in a balanced binary tree. And then we can, with this, double check that, for example, the n log n behavior that you expect is effectively respected by your implementation. So we can use the performance unit test to check the performance of low-level primitives such as pthread mutex, ADA protected objects, etc. So this is a performance unit test which is verifying various things. So it checks the low-level pthread calls that we are available on Linux. We can compare with a protected object, a higher-level ADA concept for these kind of things. We have also some timing here in this unit performance unit test system called clock get time clock monotonic 40 nanoseconds for this one, clock get time, but for the thread CPU time, about 400 nanoseconds. Interesting to remember these figures because I will speak about it a little bit later and the difference between these two. So we can also use performance unit tests to evaluate, measure, and be sure that we have the required performance for low-level library, for example, malloc. In ADA, we don't use malloc directly. We use the ADA language allocation, deallocation, but at least with GNAT, it is based on calls to the underlying malloc library. So performance unit tests, they have a lot of advantage. They are usually small, they are usually fast, and they are usually reproducible and precise. Remember our one-person objective. If there is a degradation, we want to detect it, and we want to detect with a one-person objective. Now, we have some pitfalls with performance unit tests, and I'll describe a real-life example with malloc. So malloc performance unit test, we have developed a performance unit test to compare the glibc malloc with a tc malloc and je malloc. So 7 years ago, we switched from the glibc malloc to tc malloc because we had less fragmentation and it was faster with tc malloc. All fine, all good. But when we parallelized the start simulation, where we had, for example, to recreate these 20 million in-memory indexes, we saw some not understandable 25% variation. So sometimes start simul was taking 4 seconds, and sometimes it was taking 5 seconds. And this, we saw that the performance difference was varying depending on linking a little bit more or less code in the executable, but this code was not called. And so the size, minimal change to the size of the executable were causing difference. And so we said, let's analyze where this is coming from. And we started to analyze with Valgrin called Green to really see in detail the instruction executed. And we saw no difference. We used the Linux perf tool to analyze then what was the behavior not under the Valgrin called Green simulator, but the real stuff. And perf shows effectively that the TC malloc slow pass was called a lot more when we had maybe 10 bytes more or 100 bytes less of executable code not called. We couldn't understand this mystery. We saw it was more often in the slow pass, but we couldn't determine why. So we said, that's easy. Now we will remeasure the malloc library. So we do a malloc performance unit test, n tasks, simulating our indexer task, doing m million malloc, and then m million free. What have we seen? We saw that glibc was slower, but had consistent performance with this unit test. Je malloc with this performance unit test was significantly faster than tc malloc. We were really happy. But when we use GE malloc with the real code, the real start simul with the complete system was slower with GE malloc. So what was the conclusion? More work needed on the unit test so that it better simulates what we have to do. So we continue to work on the unit test. After improving the unit test to better reflect the start simulation work, what have we seen? TC malloc was slower with many threads, but became faster when the unit test was doing L loops of simulating startup simul. So you start the unit test, TC malloc, once. You start the unit test, start simul once with GE malloc. TC malloc slower. But when you say to TC malloc, start, stop, start, stop, start, stop, then it was faster. So our unit test was still not okay. With GE malloc, we have observed that then doing the M million free in the main task was slower. And that, in fact, when we stop simul, is the main task that is doing the free. The unit test, it does not evaluate fragmentation, and I have not put all the mysteries that we have seen with this unit test. But still, based on what we have measured, we obtain a very clear conclusion with this unit test and what to do about malloc. The very clear conclusion is that we cannot conclude from the malloc performance unit test. So currently, we have decided to keep TC malloc, and we will reevaluate with a newer JLibC in Red Hat 8. We are currently on Red Hat 7, because on Red Hat 7, the JLibC is quite old. Okay, so pitfall of performance unit test. As we have seen, it's difficult to have a performance unit test which is representative of the real load. Malloc, we obtain no conclusion. The pthread mutex timing that we have seen, well, it was a very simple measure. In fact, we have measured without contention. But what should we do? We should maybe also measure with contention and what type of contention and so on. And if we have to have a unit test representative of the reload, what kind of contention do you have in the reload? And if you measure and you see where you have contention and you simulate this in your performance unit test, that might be for your current release, but if you change your code, the pattern of contention might change. And so performance unit tests are nice, small, fast, but it's difficult to have them representative. Even for hash table, binary trees, and so on, the real behavior depends on the key types of the hash function, of the compare function, of the distribution of the key values, etc. So if it is already difficult to have performance unit tests for such low-level algorithms, what about performance unit tests for more complex algorithms? For example, how to have a representative trajectory calculation performance unit test. You remember the picture at the beginning. How do you do a performance unit test for that? With which data? How many airports? Route airspaces? With what flights? A lot of short haul, a lot of long haul, flying where? You might have a lot of variation in the data. So, conclusion on performance unit tests, these are useful, somewhat useful, but they are largely insufficient. And so for this, the solution is to complement, in fact, to do most of the performance tracking, not with performance unit tests, but to measure and track performance with a full system and the real data. So we want to replay one day of operational data. So replay operational data. The operational system, ETFMS, it records all its external input. So it records the messages that are modifying the state of the system, the flight plan, the radar position, etc. It records the query messages in an offline, in a front-end system. It's not really ETFMS recording it. For example, queries such as flight list entering France between 10 and 12, which might be asked by France, for example, by the France Control Center. This is recorded. And so we have a replay tool. ETFMS is a replay tool which can replay the input data. So of course, it means that the new release that we are preparing, we must be able to replay the somewhat recent old input format. So this brings a little bit of constraint on the development. And with this, we have some difficulties. We need several days of input to replay one day, because you can have flights that are filed several days in advance. So if you have a flight today, the flight plan might have been filed 2 days in advance, and so we have to replay more days. Now, what is the elapsed time that we need to replay several days of operational data? This is a problem, of course. What is the hardware needed to replay the full operational data? Well, we have seen that we have, let's say, a medium-sized server and workstation. If a developer wants to evaluate the impact of a performance, or we want to track daily, well, we have to ask then quite a lot of hardware. So that's a problem to replay the full operational data. Now also, we want, as you remember, our objective of 1% or better, how to have a sufficiently deterministic replay in a multi-process system, multi-threaded system. This is quite a challenge, and we will describe it a little bit after. Remember, 1%. So, volume of data to replay. So replaying the full operational input is too heavy, and so the compromise is to replay the full data that changes the state of the system, flight plan, radar data, etc., but to replay only a subset of the query load. So we replay only 1 hour of the query load of the real system. And even in this, we replay a subset of the background and the bad jobs. We also have a problem that replaying in real time is too slow. As I have said, if we have to replay several days to have the result of one day, if we replay in real time, it means several days. If you want to do daily tracking of the performance, you have a lot of replays that will be in parallel a little bit everywhere. And so we have to try to reduce the time needed to replay. But we can't just take all the input and replay it instantaneously as fast as possible without doing something, because an input must be replayed at the time it was received on ops. If you have a flight plan at 9 o'clock and a radar data at 9:30 and another one at 9:35, you can't replay the radar data together with the arrival of the flight plan. You have to wait till the radar data is a correct time to process it. So many actions also happen on timer events. And so what we need is an accelerated fast time replay mode. So what is it? The replay tool controls the clock value, and the clock value jumps over the time periods with no input and no event. And so we are processing the data at the correct simulated clock, but when there is nothing to do, the clock jumps instead of doing nothing. So the fast time mode, with all these limitations on the data and with this time control, we can now replay in one day and the data needed for one day in about 13 hours on a fast Linux workstation. We don't need anymore a big server, and we can use a workstation which is not so huge. Still, we have to take attention to the source of non-deterministic results. So one source of non-deterministic result is the network, DNFS, and so on. If the database, files, or whatever are on the network, we are not, then the replay is not the only user of the network, and that can introduce quite a lot of variation, much bigger than the one person we want to detect. So the solution for this is very easy. We replay on isolated workstations. They have their local file system, their local database, and so on. Now, another source of non-deterministic result is a system administrator. You might say, but how can a system administrator give non-deterministic result on a replay? Well, they are running jobs to audit, to see what's happening, whatever. And these jobs, if they suddenly intervene during our replay, it changes the performance. And so the solution is to discuss with the system administrator so that we can disable their job on the replay workstation. And the solution was not too difficult. Another source of non-deterministic is the security officer. They absolutely want to be sure that there is no virus, no strange thing, no root executable not allowed. And so they also want to run audit jobs and scan jobs and so on. And here also the solution is to discuss with them, but it was a little bit more difficult. We also see that non-deterministic results are obtained because of the input-output past history. You start a replay from scratch, but because you use files, a file system and a database that was already used previously, even if you removed all the files, if you clear the database, you still do not obtain exactly the same. And this was annoying us with a one-person objective. And so removing files, clearing the database was not good enough. And so before each replay, we completely recreate the file system and the database for each replay. Even with that, it was not okay, because the operating system usage history itself, if you do twice two things, one after each other on Linux, the second time it might have been, I don't know, the memory in the kernel, whatever might have been changed. And so what we do is we recreate the file system, the database, and we reboot the workstation before each replay. So with this, we still have some remaining source of non-deterministic results. For example, the time control tool, we serialize most of the input processing. Most, but not all. For example, because if we would serialize everything, it would slow down a lot the replay. For example, the radar position that have arrived at the same second, we are not replaying them one by one. We have several processes, and the several processes will process the radar data that arrived at the same second in parallel. And that can introduce some non-determinism. The replays are done on identical workstations, same hardware, as I've said, file system recreated, database recreated, rebooted. Still, Despite same hardware, same operating system, restart from scratch and so on, we are observing difference between workstations. So all workstations are not born equal. That's our conclusion. Small difference in the clock of the CPU or whatever, but we see some impact. With all these caveats and the limitation and all what we did, we have finally achieved a reasonably deterministic replay performance with three levels of results. We have a global tracking where we track the elapsed user and system CPU for a replay for in the complete system. We do a per process tracking, user and system CPU and some perf stats recording. And we have a detailed tracking. We run 1 hour of replay under Valgrind Cold Grind. This we run on the side because this takes quite a lot of time. It's very slow. It takes 26 hours, but it is very precise. So, this is a drawing. These are all the baselines that we are building. So we do continuous integration. Every day, developers are integrating. We are building and replaying. And this is the release. This is a drawing showing the performance of the tracking of the global performance of the release we are developing, where we have done this optimization for the start CPU. In green, you see the total user CPU of all the processes that are replaying. In blue, it is the total system CPU for all the processes. And in red, it is the elapsed time. So what can you see is that we have seen a very gradual improvement of the performance during the development. And this gradual improvement, but we have managed to track to see that the optimizations that we are doing were effectively optimizing, or we were able to see performance degradation on a global level using this. By the way, this and that is not that suddenly we got a quantum computer that did the replay in 0.something second. It's because we had a problem during the replay, of course. I'll discuss more in details later on this part of the graph. Remember a little bit the pattern. So that's a global tracking. We also have a per process tracking where we record the user system CPU, the heap status, how much was used, free, TC malloc details because we are using TC malloc and so on. So that's the kind of thing that we will record for each process so that we can see what's happening. Here we see four processes which are processing flight. The counter there is the one which is processing flight list and counts and so on. And for each of these processes, we are recording data that allows us to understand which process, if we see a difference on the big global graph, which process has increased. And then the third level is when we have to analyze what has happened inside a process. Then we have 1 hour of replay under Valgrind Cold Grind, and then we use the excellent Kcache Grind tool and the excellent Cold Grind tool to record the cold stack, who has spent what. We can see the functions which have consumed the topmost, and we can see the code which jumps we have, which condition was called was often true or false, and we can go up to the assembly language level. So this is the main tool we are using when we want to optimize some specific algorithms or when we see a degradation. By the way, I'm also the organizer of the debugging tool, DevRoom, and tomorrow there is a talk about, at least one talk about Valgrind. So if you are interested, that was the advertisement. So another interesting thing to discuss is that what we measure is we want to avoid performance degradation, but we also want to see that if we believe we are doing an optimization, is that really an optimization? And that's a real-life example of what we believe was a missed optimization, something that we could optimize, that we tried to optimize, and then it was becoming a failed optimization. So this is the slide with a little bit of ADA code. I promised to Jean-Pierre and Derek that we would have some lines of ADA code. Here they are. So here what we see a little bit of code of a task, an ADA task, and it has two rendezvous. It accepts, so this task is maintaining the automatic loading of data, like when the airports are changing and whatever. It's synchronizing the access and the load of this data. So while someone is accessing this data, it must be locked, and when it is not locked, the task will load new data in the memory. And so this task, among others, has to maintain the number of locks, and so it accepts So it has a rendezvous which is called unlock, where when a client task says, I don't need a lock anymore, it's calling unlock, and the task decrements the number of locks. And there is also a rendezvous called getLockCount, which returns the current lock to the client. What is it used for? This is used for because when a process is activated to handle something, like a flight plan, it will take some locks. But when it has finished to process the flight plan, it's not supposed to have a lock anymore. And so at the top level of the processing, we are checking that there is no lock by calling this, this get lock count. Okay, a rendezvous, a data task is something which is relatively costly because it is a task calling between quotes another task. So there is a task switch, there is some system call to synchronize and so on. So it's relatively expensive. And so the optimization idea was to decrease the number of rendezvous by using lower level synchronization based on volatile. That was the optimization idea. The idea was to take locks not as a task maintained variable, but as a variable, a global volatile variable. We have a function that returns the value, and inside the task, we now accept unlock, and then we are doing the decrement in the body. Why do we have to do it in the body while above the unlock, the decrement was done outside of the body? Because imagine that you have the task which is processing my flight plan. It has finished. It releases the last lock and just after says, no, I will check that there is zero lock. Here, with this solution, we must absolutely be sure that when the task that says unlock gets the lock count, that it must have been done. And so we must do it in the body because otherwise, possibly, we could have a race condition in our check. So this should be faster because we will have the same number of unlock rendezvous, but we will have much faster get lock counts. Accessing a volatile variable is much faster than a rendezvous. And so this is supposed to be much, much faster. That was the idea. In reality, we detected with the performance tracking that this was a pessimization, this thing. The compiler, the ADA compiler, is quite efficient and helps us to build high-level synchronization algorithms in an efficient way. And so, for example, if you have a nobody rendezvous, then the compiler will optimize this and it will be a lot less costly to have a nobody rendezvous than to have a body in the unlock calls. And so because of this becoming more heavy, in fact, it was a pessimization. And this was detected. This is the extract of the big drawing at the beginning. So this was without the optimization. Here we had the little bit of problem. And here was with the optimization. And you see that the system time slightly increased. So here we start to say, what have we done during several releases? And after, we have said, we better roll back. And so here, we have rolled back the optimization so that we are back at the original system time performance. So what can we conclude about that? Is that you need to track performance. You need to track performance because otherwise you can have problems. You have to track performance of your optimization because otherwise it might become pessimization. And a third thing to remember is that you can believe you are maybe smarter than the compiler, but it's difficult. Difficult, but not impossible, because here you see we did the optimization correctly, not using volatile, but using atomic and doing a part of the decrement. The decrement operation was done outside of the task, and so it all went okay. So we detect here that we can optimize something. We optimize, but it is a pessimization. We ask ourselves, why are we so stupid? We understand it, and then after we become more intelligent. So that's quite positive as an evolution. So, performance tracking a summary. We have good dev performance tracking using a mix of performance unit tests, replay operational data as deterministic as possible. The replay day, we have to change it because the pattern of usage might change. We might have new companies appearing, airspace being restructured, new route, old route, and so on. So we change the reference day that we compare relatively frequently so as to match new usage pattern. We use various tools. Valgrind, Colgrind, KKHGrind, Perf, Top, and so on. But we have to take care about blind spot of your tools. For example, Valgrind, Colgrind, KKHGrind is very easy to use. It's really a main tool we are using to optimize, but it is very slow and it serializes multi-threaded application. And so it measures something for contention. For example, you never have any contention when you run something under Valgrind, Colgrind. And it had a limited system call measurement. It was not measuring the number of system calls and the elapsed time in system call, but not the system CPU. And we saw here, in our case, the system CPU had to measure. As I also happen to be a Valgrind developer, I change Valgrind so that now it also measures the system CPU spent in system calls. So we need to have global indicators. We have to zoom on the details where needed. And as I have said, improvement in the pipeline, the next version of Valgrind, Colgrind will measure system CPU. And we are also working on developing a Colgrind diff to help visualizing the difference because currently comparing the KKHGrind graphs is a little bit difficult. So it looks wonderful. We have a nice tracking system, nice graph. We can measure from the top, from the global system to the details of the process. And can we be happy with that? Is that good enough to go operational? What about you are on call, or me, I'm on call, because I'm on call from time to time, and you are waking up Saturday 4 o'clock because the users are complaining that the system is slow. I can't reply. I will replay tomorrow, Sunday, the day, and on Monday I'll explain you why we had big problems on Saturday. This is not acceptable. We have other questions like, is the reference day that we replay, is it representative of what happens on ops? We need some indication for that. What about evolution of the ops workload and capacity planning? For example, if we say we believe that our users will do a lot more queries to optimize their routes because we have improved, because we have new users that will say we want to use our service, Will the system cope, or do we have to change the hardware setup? Do we have to upgrade the hardware, put more hardware? For this, we need something else than the replay. For example, what additional capacity, hardware capacity is needed to support each time more queries of that specific type? The solution for this is to have permanently activate response time monitoring and statistics. So this I'm speaking about the tactical response time, tactical because it's mostly useful during tactical operation, but we of course also use this during the replay or the development. The idea of this is that the application contains measurement code at critical points, such as every remote procedure call invocation begin end. So one process is invoking something in another process. It will measure how long it took. At the process side that execute the remote procedure call, we will also measure how much it took to process and send back the reply. We are measuring the database access time, begin end of the database, and significant algorithm begin end, such as calculate a vertical trajectory, and so on and so on. So the measurements are typically nested. For example, inside an RPC execution begin end, we will order begin end for sub things that are being used by the thing. So this tact response time package maintains a circular buffer with the last M measurement, so the begin-end measurement. And for each begin-end measurement, it records the elapsed time, the thread CPU time, optionally the full process CPU time. You remember at the beginning, I said clock get time monotonic and clock get time thread CPU. This is measured with clock get time monotonic, and this is measured with clock get time thread CPU. This is relatively heavy, costly. This is, in fact, a virtual system call implemented for those that know in the VDSO of Linux. And this is really switching to kernel to get the data. So if there are kernel developers in the room, if you could improve the clock get time thread CPU, that would be really nice. So this package also maintains statistics, how many measurements of what kind were done, an histogram of elapsed thread CPU, and details about the n worst case. This is giving a reasonable overhead. About 1.7% of the CPU is spent in measuring what the application is doing rather than doing real work. And for this, we largely prefer to have it always activated on ops and on our test and replay and so on, because this is critical for us to understand what's happening in our system. So this is an example of, we have an online access to this data structure. So this is a screen which allows to look interactively if you are called, for example, during the night, what's happening. And you see here a kind of tree of actions, where we have received a flight plan, we had a flight deviation, then we did several derivation phase for the calculation of the trajectory. We read the flight in the database. We calculate another concept. Finally, we have distributed some data, and we have committed at the end the data in the database. And so we can track the details of what's happening in the last M measurements. This is the statistics that are maintained. So we maintain how many measurements we had. the total time spent, elapsed real thread CPU, the average, and a distribution, an histogram of the distribution, and the n worst case. In case something is really abnormal, it will appear in this data structure. So this stacked response time, as I've indicated, is used from development to operation. On development, it helps to understand how the system works, see message exchange between process, the algorithms executed. The statistics are used to analyze the performance replay. We can compare, using this stacked response time, the profile of the replay day with the ops profile. We can measure the resource consumption for new functionalities because we are recording things that are need to be recorded and so on. On ops, online investigation of performance problem, bug investigation in our system, in our code, the policies that exceptions are used for bugs, not for normal behavior. And so if we have an exception, we take a core dump. We can take a core dump without stopping the process. We take a core dump, we drop the input that has created the problem, and we process the next message. And the core dump contains the full status of what the thing was doing, including in the tact response line, the last M measurement of what the process did. Because possibly the bug might be created by something that was done a little bit before. And so with this, we can see what the process was doing and recently did. We also use this for post-ops analysis and thread analysis and input for our capacity planning. So, performance tracking of a big application, a summary. So, we have a reasonably deterministic performance tracking during development. It allows us to detect performance regression on a daily basis. We can verify that the optimization, that we believe are optimization, have the desired effect. It allows us to plan capacity upgrade for demand growth and new functionality, etc. We are using a mix of various techniques and tools, such as performance unit tests, replay real data, application self-measurement. We have to take care to avoid blind spots by using various tools, Perf, Valgrind, Colgrind, Top, S-Trace. All will learn you something about your application. The tooling we are also using for other purposes, for example, the replay tool is also an automatic testing tool, because if we say we can replay 50,000 flight plans, we can also say inject two flight plans and verify that this one has this characteristic and that it has received this delay, for example. So the replay tool is also the test tool. It is also used by our users to analyze, optimize operational actions and procedure. If they did something and they say, maybe we should have done something else, they can replay, of course, on offline systems, and then they can decide to try other actions than what they did during operations. So as I've indicated, your operational system needs to have performance tracking and statistics. This is not only for development. Voilà, so that finishes my presentation. Yes?
When you have new features coming into the system, are you injecting fake queries for that into the real live data to basically get them into the real live data before there's action in the live data?
Yes, typically.
Yes. Can you repeat the question? Yes. Otherwise, it's.
Okay, so the question is, when we implement new features, do we inject some data in the replay in order to see how it behaves? Yes, the idea is that during the development, when we implement a new feature, we are of course developing unit tests for this new feature, which are done with the replay tool. And whenever we have relevant data that we can use, we might have to discuss with our users, or we might have to create them ourselves. We will measure how the code that we have developed behaves. Now, it's very difficult to know what to do exactly, because the real usage depends a lot of the pattern that the real users will do. And sometimes users are a big source of non-determinism. Yes? Most of the load, yes.
Yeah, so is this like, how is this maintained to be like highly available? Or?
Okay, so the question is, I've said that it runs on one server, and so how is this highly reliable? Yes, I said, when it is working, it's enough to have one server. But of course, we have several servers, we have cluster of servers, and if one server has an hardware problem, for example, we move the system to another hardware server. So operationally, it's good enough to have, let's say medium-sized Linux server, but we can move the application to another place. Yes?
You've shown that you are going down to nanosecond metrics.
In the. Yes?
Yeah, so the source of time, if you are distributing the calculus or the measurement of the process, do you lock the core so that you don't get outgoing timestamps before ingoing timestamps?
No, we are just taking. So, first, the nanosecond measure. So, the question was, how do we ensure precise measurement in the multiprocess? So, first, the measurement that I showed were performance unit tests. And so, this we just have typically a single executable, which is a performance unit test. In the real system, we just say this process has consumed this task has consumed this CPU. To do this action in that elapsed time. No, what we want to measure is what is really happening. Let's imagine, for example, that we have somewhere a kind of critical sections, and two processes are accessing some data and are locking this data. You might have that one process has to wait a long time, so that we will see, because it says, I see that I have spent, 0.1 second waiting and consume only 1 millisecond of CPU. Either there was not enough CPU on the system, it was overloaded, or there is wait time, and so we just measure what the kernel gives back via the clock get time system calls. Other questions? No?
Thank you. All speakers.